Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
And are we yet alive and see each other's face? Glory and thanks to Jesus give for His almighty grace. Preserved by power divine to full salvation here. Again in Jesus' praise we join and in His sight appear. What troubles have we seen? What mighty conflicts past? Fightings without and fears within, since we assembled last. Yet out of all the Lord hath brought us by His love, and still He doth His help afford, and hides our life above. Then let us make our boast of His redeeming power, which saves us to the uttermost, till we can sin no more. Let us take up the cross, till we the crown obtain, and gladly reckon all things lost, so we may Jesus gain.
Thank you. O Lord, O Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Your glory fills the heavens beyond the farthest star. How excellent is your name in all the earth. Lord, we acknowledge that you are the excellent and righteous one. We humbly come before you, Heavenly Father, acknowledging that you alone can supply us with an abundance of your peace. Peace, joy, contentment, not just words, but what we need to seek and embrace. Fill us with your spirit of peace and contentment until there's no room left to wallow in disappointments, complaints, and disturbances that come into our lives seeking to devour and take priority. When disturbances and interruptions and disappointments do come, we pray that we would take them as the fire kindling us to be closer to you, Heavenly Father. Give us a spirit of contentment, Lord, that by the calm of our countenance and the peace of our lives in the world or close at home, we can be evangelists for you. We thankfully receive the spiritual fruit through the abiding love of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Saving God, the God who Christ Jesus offers us release from all that oppresses us. Transforming God, the God who changes us from the inside out. God of the impossible. The God who is able to do for us more than we can ask or imagine. As we bow our heads in your presence on this night, we come seeking a word from you which may transform our existence, a word from you which may transform our broken and often painful world. We are deeply conscious of and deeply grieved by the state of our world, so we come seeking change, change which only you, the God of the impossible, can initiate. Open our ears on this night, that we may hear what you have to say to us, and incline our hearts to your purposes, we pray, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Reflect with me for a while on these words from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Today, April the 28th, is celebrated as National Heroes Day in Barbados. It is a day on which we Bajans honor those persons who, by their living, espouse fundamental and unchanging ideals, demonstrated special traits and attributes. It is a day on which we commemorate those persons whose lives transformed the Barbadian society and held up before us an image of who we can be. The concept of national heroes is not unique to Barbados. It has been embraced by many other Caribbean nations in their nation-building enterprise. Now it seems to me that the Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Rome, called the church then and calls us Christians now to live the lives of national heroes. That is, lives of courage, lives of self-sacrifice, and lives which contribute to the social transformation of our societies. It seems to me that Paul's call to Christians of every age, including us, to not be conformed to this world, to present our bodies as living sacrifices, as offerings to God, and to be transformed so that we may know the perfect will of God, is a call for each of us to experience an extraordinarily impactful, meaningful human existence. But let me be clear. Paul was not preaching any salvation by works theology. Paul was not saying that we are saved by what we do. Not at all. In the first 11 chapters of his epistle to the Romans, Paul had outlined to the church at Rome his understanding of the gospel, his understanding of salvation. He had shared with the church how through faith in the crucified and risen Christ, the Christian avails himself of God's grace, God's mercy, and God's compassion. In his first 11 chapters, Paul had shared with the church how through faith in Christ, the Christian is saved. Paul used terms like justification, redemption, and reconciliation to define what God in Christ had done for us. But now, in chapter 12, Paul argues that because of what Christ has made possible, therefore, as a consequence of what God has accomplished for us, the Christian must be radically different from others. Christians, says Paul, must undergo dramatic changes in their nature, their function, and their condition. Changes, Paul believes, which flow out of being saved through faith in Christ. Changes, Paul implies, which are our responses to God's grace. The noted English theologian John Stott once told the story of a young Hindu girl who had met some Christians for the first time. Later, the little girl was asked what she thought a Christian was. After pausing briefly, The Hindu's girl response was, "A Christian is someone who is different from everybody else." Now, it is unlikely that this Hindu girl had ever read the book of Romans, but she seemed to have fully grasped the context within which Paul wrote his epistle. For Paul, Christians were indeed supposed to be different, radically different from everybody else. For Paul, Christians were to become like national heroes. You see, Paul was calling on Christians then and now, firstly, to live lives of courage. He wrote, "Do not be conformed to this world." When Paul wrote this epistle, the Roman Emperor Claudius Augustus had declared himself to be the Son of God, the Prince of Peace, God incarnate on earth. People actually said then about the Roman emperors what we say now about Christ. In Paul's time, every Roman citizen knew that the Roman emperor was the most powerful person of the day. Everybody, that is, except Paul. At that time, Paul was writing letters to people telling them about another emperor. Paul was telling people about a teacher from Judea who was the authentic Son of God, the true Prince of Peace, the real God incarnate. Paul was writing letters to a new group of people, a group referred to as Christians, telling them that in Christ there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female. According to Paul, in Christ everyone was equal, and the only power that mattered was the power of God, not the power of the Roman emperor. Paul's letters were in effect calls to Christians to be courageous, to be different from everybody else. Paul's letters were calls to the church of his time to be revolutionary, to be radical, to go against the accepted norms. And so he wrote to the Christians of Rome and to us, "Do not be conformed to this world." In other words, be non-conformists. So what might courageous living, being nonconformist, look like for us today? Like Paul, it requires us to stand up and speak out against corrupt and immoral governance structures. Structures which support discrimination and promote the creation of an underclass. In our time, it requires that we fearlessly fight against a greedy, exploitative merchant class, those who seek to profit off the backs of the impoverished. In our time, it requires that we boldly and publicly protest and root out the hypocritical practices in the church, practices which drive others away from God. In our time, it demands that we ignore the enticement of the advertising industry to quench our thirst for more and more material goods, more and more alcohol and illicit drugs, more and more promiscuous sex, more and more power. It requires courage to be able to say, enough is enough. I believe Paul's call to Christians to be courageous nonconformists is a call to Christians to exist, to exert influence on society's norms. I believe it is a call for Christians to be agents of change. In a sermon he delivered on this text, the great civil rights leader Martin Luther King provided a striking illustration to show how the non-conforming Christian may influence the world. Dr. King said, "We have a choice. We may either be a thermometer or a thermostat." The thermometer, he argues, simply records the temperature. It merely reflects society's norms. On the other hand, the thermostat controls the temperature adjusting it as is desirable. King argues that the courageous, non-conforming Christian makes a choice to be society's thermostat, not its thermometer. A second way in which Paul counsels us to live like national heroes is with the injunction to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is our spiritual worship. In other words, live lives of self-sacrifice. Deny our personal interests. We can hear Jesus' words in Paul's call to live sacrificially. For it was Jesus who had early declared, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves." We can hear the words of our covenant in Paul's call to live sacrificially when we declare each year, "I am no longer my own, I belong to you." And we continue, "I lay my whole life on the altar and yield myself and all I have to your pleasure and disposal." You see, it is a Christian's faith in Jesus. It is our sharing in Jesus' death and resurrection through baptism. It is our receiving of the Holy Spirit, our being renewed in Christ, which marks us as part of a new group, which gives us a new identity. And so Jesus' desires ought to be central to any understanding of God's will for our lives. One striking aspect of Jesus' desires for Christians, one understanding of God's will for our lives, may be found at Mark chapter 10 and verse 45. "For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." Beloved, in the same way that Christ desired to be a servant, so too must the transformed Christian be a servant. The transformed Christian gives his body, his life, in service that others may experience liberty. Beloved, genuine worship of God is to offer our bodies, our lives to God for God's purposes. Hear how Paul says this to the Corinthian church: "For you were bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." In other words, we are to glorify God with our lives. We are to worship God with our living. We are to present our bodies, our lives, as a living sacrifice to God. The Old Testament is replete with the various offerings the early Israelites were to present to God in worship. But Jesus offered himself as a sacrifice for us, in obedience to God, as worship to God. In like manner, says Paul, we too are to live lives which worship God. What might such a life look like, you ask? Not only must it be a life of service to others, it must also be a life in which we love even our enemies, a life in which we are salt and light to our communities, a life of extraordinary generosity, a life in which we go beyond hearing the word of God to doing the word of God, a life in which we run the race set before us. The hymn writers fully accepted what Paul is telling us when the apostle enjoins us to worship God with our lives. One writes, "Take my will and make it thine. It will be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne." Another adds, "All to Jesus I surrender. Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessing fall on me." He continues, all to Jesus I surrender. Now I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation. Glory, glory to his name. Beloved, Paul sought to address the social and political issues of his time. He challenged the church of his day to deny the power of the emperor and to experience the power of the crucified Christ. He challenged Christians of every age to be transformed. But for Paul, transformation was not something we do by ourselves. Transformation is what we allow to be done to us. You see, transformation really requires our submission to God's power, so that by his grace we may become a new creation. As Paul himself wrote to the Corinthian church, so if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See? Everything has become new. And Paul adds in the following verse, all this is from God. Transformation is beyond our abilities. We can let go of self. Let go of always watching out for self. And instead, give God our full attention. As Christians, we can experience transformation when we make space for God, when we allow God to reveal himself to us, and in revealing himself, to transform us. Beloved, when we contemplate God in prayer, when we ponder God's word, when we are still and know that God is God, when we wait expectantly on God until God comes, we will know that in his coming, his grace, his mercy, his compassion will invade our minds, overwhelm our consciousness, and transform us into courageous, selfless persons, willing to deny our personal interests and contribute to significant social change in our community. In other words, to become national heroes. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, on this night for your word of challenge to us. We know that your word does not return to you void, but accomplishes that which you purpose. May your word to us on this night bring forth fruit 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard here, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. To our God and Father, be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.